It just got kicked from the session, so I don't know if it's just me or if there was a problem. Okay, so who is the speaker for the first talk?
Which of the papers are first?
It's the other one, not yours.
All right.
So I see that there's Marco Muniz as an attendee, so maybe he's supposed to be the speaker and you should promote him. I don't know. Okay. 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 So Sebastian was supposed to give the talk is six, so Marco will be answering the questions, and I guess that anyway, the video is from Sebastian. So maybe we can wait just a bit more. Thanks, Marco. So good afternoon to everyone who is here, or maybe good morning, I don't know where you are. But I'm sticking to the time zone of Créteil, so. Okay, I see the slides are coming up, so I guess that's my clue. So the first talk will be given by Sebastian Lund, and then Marco Muniz will answer the questions. So this work is an integer static analysis for better extrapolation in UPAM. So I guess we can start.
Hello, my name is Sebastian Lund, and I will be presenting our paper on an integer static analysis for better extrapolation in UPAL. This is work by my fellow students, Jesper van Diepen, Tobias Janssen, Tobias Andersen, and myself, and under supervision of Marco Muniz and Kim G. Larsen. So how could an integer static analysis help extrapolation in UPAL? So how extrapolation is done in UPAL is based on maximal constants that clocks are compared to. But we work with extended time automata in UPAL, so we have integer variables as well. So in this case here, we have an automata that compares a clock to an integer variable. And what should the range be here? Right now in UPAL, it goes by the type of the variable. So in most cases, that would be max int or max short. Here in this case, it's max short. And what happens is that we cannot perform extrapolation before we reach this very high constant, whereas in with our analysis we can perform extrapolation right after we hit 7 here. So that's a pretty large reduction in states in this toy model. So to understand the method, we have to understand a bit about extended time automata. So I'll explain a bit here, and there's more detail in the paper. So extended time automata are an extension to time automata by Allure and Dell. And what has been extended is that there are now discrete variables. So we still have clocks, and what we have here is a clock valuation. It's a function from variables to the positive reals. And then we have some notation here denoting the set of all possible clock valuations. And then what's new is we have V, a set of discrete variables, and each variable has a domain denoted by DV. And we have, similar to clocks, variable valuations that map variables to values in that domain. So what's also different is constraints in XTAs. So constraints denoted BX are generated by this grammar here. So we can compare clocks to expressions, and we can have conjunctions of these constraints. So what's new is that this can be an expression, whereas in time automata that would just be a constant. And what we also have is variable constraints, which are basically just Boolean variable constraints, what you could imagine there. And then we have this set here, BXV, which is just notation for any conjunction you could imagine of clocks and variable constraints, which is, these are the types of constraints we have on guards on edges. So updates are also different. So in time automata, you would only be able to assign constants to clocks. Here we can assign expressions to clocks and variables through what we call updates. And we have this set here, UXV, which denotes all infinite, all finite sequences of clock and variable updates. And then we have some notation here for applying an update. So here we have a clock valuation, applying the update to the clock valuation under the current variable valuation. Then we get the new resulting variable valuation from applying the update. And the same over here. Yes, okay. And then a bit about the semantics for the XTA. It looks a bit complicated, but it's not that bad. So here we have three types of transitions in XTAs. One is delay, so we remain in the same location, and the only thing we update is the clock valuation, and the only limitation here is that we have to satisfy the invariant at the current location under the variable valuation to be allowed to take this transition, and it's a positive real delay. Then we have internal transitions, and these internal transitions are defined by the edges in the automata. So we have from some location to another location, we have some clock guard and some variable guard and some update. And essentially what happens here is that we have to ensure that the clock valuation satisfies the clock guard, and the variable valuation satisfies the variable guard, and then we update the variable valuation, update the clock valuation, and we ensure that the new clock valuation satisfies the invariant. That's all that's happening. Then we also have the potential for handshake transitions in UFL. So that's because we work with networks of XTAs. So two XTAs can communicate by both having an enabled edge, one with an exclamation mark and one with a question mark. And essentially the rule here is just the same as internal, but there has to be another one to match the handshake. Yes. So to perform our abstract interpretation, we need to represent our symbolic states. So the way concrete states are represented are, we denote them by cube, but it's this location tuple because we have network of XTAs and some clock valuation and some variable valuation. And then we can define the concrete domain as the power set of these concrete states. So this is sometimes referred to as the collecting semantics, but what we do is we define the post here of some state in this power set here as the next states that are possible for all possible states. So this is just the semantic we defined here. If the semantics allow a transition, then that should be in the post. And then we can define the reachable states as a fixed point of this post function from the initial state. And then for our analysis, we would like to focus on the variable valuations. So what we do is we abstract away the clock valuations, assume that we can have all possible clock valuations. And instead of considering tuples of locations, we just have for each location, we assign it with the variable valuations. And we also, instead of having a set of variable valuations, we have a polyhedron, because it's nice to be able to represent it with a convex, and that's very efficient. So for those unfamiliar with what convex polyhedra are, it is the convex closure of a system of generators. So a set of vertices and a set of rays, and it is essentially, you define a set of vertices and points, which are points and rays, and then it's just the convex of that is the polyhedron. It can also be defined as the set of solutions to a system of linear inequalities, which we will sometimes make use of because it's easier in some cases, and you can interchange between these representations. So for our abstraction and concretization, to translate between these states, we define our abstraction as basically for every location, we would like to have the convex closure of the variable valuations that are available in that location. So given some state, we have a bunch of locations with variable valuations, and we would like to assign the locations to the convex closure of those. And then going the other way around, going from an abstract state to a concrete state, we take we take all possible clock valuations, that's where we over approximate a bit, and then we take all the possible values in the convex representation of the variable valuations, and that's essentially all that's happening. And then we have a lemma that this is a Galois connection. So essentially what we have is that it's auto-preserving, which ensures that our analysis is correct and an over-approximation. So essentially what you have to prove is this by implication. So now we would like to define our abstract posterior. So one way of defining how to do the posterior in abstract states is to perform the concretization, then perform our concrete post, and then perform the abstraction afterwards. But this is often infeasible because we have potentially infinitely many variable valuations. So we would like to define an over approximation of this for all edges. So the first thing you do is we treat all synchronizations as tau transitions, so internal transitions. That's always an over approximation because synchronization can only limit the possible transitions. And then we'd like to define intersections with variable constraints. So luckily a lot of variable constraints are linear inequalities already. In the case where they are linear inequalities, we can take the linear inequality representation of the polyhedra and just union that with the linear inequality of this. In the other case where it's not a linear inequality, we simply do nothing. That's also an over approximation because you cannot add anything by intersecting with the guard. So and we use this notation. But how do we apply updates to polyhedrons? Well, that's a bit more complicated. So what we do is linear assignments on polyhedra. This is also sometimes called the affine image of a polyhedra. So given a polyhedra and a linear assignment, so some matrix and a vector, we can define the image, which is for all points in this polyhedra rotated and applied translation. That's the definition, but you can do this simply under generators and arrays. So you can translate the vertices and rotate the rays, and then that defines the polyhedra. But one problem is that we have nonlinear assignments allowed. So for example, here we have a modulo, which is not linear. But what we do know is that these are bounded by two linear assignments, so an upper and lower bound. So in this case, it would be 0 and 10, which bounds this. And then what we can simply do is take the compute the lower bound image and the upper bound image and take the convex union of those. And that represents the entire possible range of such expressions. And we know that all expressions are bounded, because we can, in the worst case, just take the variable type range or the expression type range, the intersection of those, and that's an upper or lower bound always. So we also abuse a bit of notation here by using this notation to apply successively all of the variable updates in R to a polyhedra by this notation. And then we can define our abstract posterior. So for all the edges in some automata, we would like to have a posterior of an abstract state. So here we have from some location to another location. The way we do it here is we take the bottom element of our, so we have a lattice of our abstract states, and the bottom element simply assigns all locations to the empty set. And what we would like here is that the new location should have the polyhedron representing the old polyhedron intersected with the guard updated with the updates. And then we have a bunch of edges, so we just take the union of all of those. And that's the abstract posterior. And we claim that this is an over approximation. And what you simply have to do is prove for delay and internal transitions. So handshake transitions are converted into internals, essentially. So, and delay transitions are pretty obviously handled because we include the state itself in the post, and we have all possible clock valuations. So delay transitions are always handled, and internal transitions are also pretty well handled. The only thing there is just that we have convex representations, but convex representations are always an over approximation of concave representations. So in that case, we also, that's essentially the proof for the internals. Then to actually terminate with our analysis, we employ widening. So for those unfamiliar with widening, a widening operator is a function such that here, nabla, that's applied to two elements of some set, and the widening has to be greater than both elements, and all increasing chains should not be strictly increasing. And one of the most well-known here is the so-called standard widening from Cousseau and Halbwachs. That is this here, P nabla Q, where it's just defined by the subset of inequalities that are satisfied by all points in Q. There are other works on more precise widening operators, such as Halbwachs, Proy, and Rumanov, who did a very similar analysis to us, and then More recently, a more precise widening by Roberto Birkner et al. Our analysis, or our widening, is inspired by Helberg's Proy and Romanov's widening. So what we do is similar to the widening up to. Essentially, what we have is a set of linear inequalities for each location, and what we do is we widen, we perform standard widening, and then we intersect with the inequalities that are satisfied by both both abstract states. So one way of thinking of this is that the set of linear inequalities we have is a set of guesses that we try until they're proven wrong by the next iteration. So what we have is for each location a set of invariants for all simple cycles from L, so cycles from L to itself. And then we also have this transition control, transmission control protocol modeled from Saini and Twenker not so long ago, where they modeled this model without any backoff, but by the specification of CCP, there should be an exponential backoff. What we find is that with exponential backoff, we cannot model those relations, but we can model a linear backoff. So yeah, that's one of the limitations of our method currently. And then we also considered the model from the initial motivational slide with varying constants. So here are some of the results for our state space reductions. So for the simple model here, for example, the one you saw was with the constant of 7. And you can see that the reduction is, of course, much more massive the larger the smaller the actual constant is. Yeah, that makes sense. And then what we find in these scheduler models here, as p increases, we have more clocks. So p is the number of clocks, essentially. And what we find is that we have almost an exponential reduction in states visited here, and we can essentially have twice as many processes analyzed with this deadlock query as without our analysis, in much faster. What we also see is that in UFL there are three different types of extrapolations: maximal constant and difference extrapolation and lower upper bound extrapolation. And we see that we also improve difference extrapolation, not by as much, but by some. And then here for the CCP models, we see that we also help queries that are reachability queries. So this is a query that checks whether all TCP connections are established. And this star here denotes that this one is not satisfied, and these down here are satisfied. So what we see is that reachability queries that are not satisfied are reduced a lot with our analysis, but reachability queries that are satisfied are not reduced very much with our analysis, which makes sense because unsatisfied reachability queries have to visit a lot of states and we reduce states. So yeah. And finally, we have two models here, TTPA and TTAC, where we see no reduction at all. And that's essentially because the invariants in these models allow the clock valuations to never reach above the maximal constant. So there's no place where you can actually perform extrapolation. So the maximal constant wouldn't matter even though it's available. But what we find is that the overhead of our analysis is 1 second in these cases, so it's negligible. Another interesting part of doing stuff like this for a verification engine is that we can actually verify that our implementation is correct, for at least for the tested models. So what we do is we take the variable bounds that we identify in the TTPA and TTAC models, and we perform model checking queries to check whether these bounds are actually correct. And we've actually find that most of these bounds are exact. So the ones marked with daggers are exact, and the only ones that are not exact are these middle dates here. But all queries are satisfied. So it's a pretty interesting potential to have automatic test case generation for ensuring that the implementation is correct. Then I'll mention some of the limitations that we found. So stuff like non-linear relations between variables seems to be a problem, and that makes sense because it is a linear relation analysis that we perform. So you could try to map those relations some other way. And next, if we have networks with a lot of circular dependencies, the analysis won't be very useful. It will still be better than no analysis, but it won't be very useful. So one thing we considered at some point is to, for small circular dependencies, actually do the parallel composition and run the analysis there. If it's only three or two components, it should be fine. The problem is just that it's exponential, so you can't rely on it. And then I'll conclude on what we've done. Essentially what we've done is made a component level analysis. So we are linear in the number of components instead of exponential, which is nice. It makes our analysis very efficient. And the resulting bounds we find are available to all extrapolation types in UPL, and they improve them all in the cases where it matters. And theoretically, what we get is an exponential reduction in explored states. And in practice, what we see is an almost exponential reduction in most of the cases. And yeah, the analysis is very efficient. There's negligible overhead for anything, so you could essentially run it even if you don't care about the results of the analysis. So for future work, we see potentials in improving the precision of the analysis by considering arbitrary functions on edges, and potentially also what I talked about earlier, more exponential relations and stuff like that. For functions, we know that it is possible to perform abstract interpretation over functions, so you could add that. Right now we try to inline functions, but if they include for loops and while loops and if statements, we over approximate them to the range of the type. So there is some room for improvement of precision there. Also, you could try different widening operators. And then there is some recent work in urgent partial order reduction for extended time automata, which is what we're working on right now, using the analysis from this model to find more independent actions in urgent partial order reduction to improve those methods. Seems pretty promising. And then finally, it could be interesting if this analysis could be extended to support other abstractions, such as there are similar extrapolations for price timed automata and price zones from Boyer, Cologne, and Markey. So it would be interesting to see if it could be applied to something like that as well. And that was it for my talk. Thank you for listening.
Okay, so I guess everyone has been kicked for a few seconds from the session, so maybe we missed a couple of slides, but I think anyway it was possible to understand the talk. So thanks for the talk. Marco, you will tell this to Sebastian then. So Marco will answer to the questions because Sebastian is not able to be here today. So I will check if I don't see any questions for now in the Q&A. Feel free to ask questions if you have some. If not, maybe I'll start. So Marco, from what I got, it seems that the bounds that you derive from your approach in many cases are tight. Is that true?
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay.
In most experiments, they were the exact, and okay. In a few cases they were over approximations.
And so my question is, did you have a look at the cases where they are not tied? And can you get something from those cases? Maybe some idea on how to improve your approach to also get tight bounds or tighter bounds in these cases? Or
I'm afraid we haven't looked into detail on why, what is the reason, but this could be this, there is a lot of widening when there are nonlinear expressions, then there are these over approximations, and UPAL is very rich. It's the language can have loops and all these kind of expressions, and this makes the analysis a little bit more difficult. So okay. On the presence of such expressions, we over approximate.
Okay, thank you. So I see there's a question in the chat. So it's a question by Martin Frenzel. So did you encounter cases where your particular widening proved overly aggressive in that it generated very relaxed bounds? So it's kind of related to
yes.
What we just discussed.
No, I think we need to have a more detailed look into this to be more exact for this answer. So far I could just guess that this nonlinear and complicated UPAL expressions.
Okay. Are there more questions? So about this future work, so the adaptation that you need to make to make it work, for example, with UPAL and so on, do you have any idea how to do it, or is it just okay something that you would like to do? But
you mean extensions?
Yeah, I mean to. So, for example, with price time automata and so on, so you need to, your method does not work
yeah.
with that
yet. So. Yes, not yet. I know that for the abstraction in price time automata, there is some trick using some constants in the invariants. So every location needs to have an invariant, and these are usually the types. So we expect that using these could really help in price time automata, but we need to look into that.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Any more questions? Doesn't seem so. So I guess I thank you again, Marco.
Thank you.
So we'll move on to the next talk that will be given by Frederick.
Hello, and welcome to the presentation of this paper, Stop on Set Reduction for Timed Readability and Safety Games. My name is Frederick, representing the authors of this paper. First off, I will present the contributions of this paper. So this work we present in this paper is an extension on the previous work that we have done on respectively partial reductions for readability games and partial reductions for time systems. And in this paper, we are then combining these two approaches to these two areas into a unified framework for timed readability games. And furthermore, we also show that the framework that we present in this paper can also be used for preserving winning strategies for safety games in addition to readability games. And lastly, we instantiate this framework to a more concrete formalism here in this form of a timed arcpatch patchnet games, and give an efficient implementation of this in the model checking tool Tapal in order to show the practical viability of our approach. In this presentation, I'm going to go over four topics. First off, I will talk about partial reductions in general and also in the timed and game theoretical settings. Secondly, I'm going to talk about some of the sufficient conditions that are needed for preserving winning readability and safety strategies in the time setting as well. Thirdly, I will talk a bit about how we instantiate this approach to timed arc patchnet games, that is, how we generate stable reductions in this setting. And lastly, I will talk a bit about the experimental evaluation we did to show the practical viability, as well as give a conclusion. All right, So let's talk a bit about partial reductions. So to show this, I have on this slide here included a small example of a pitch net seen on the left side here, as well as its corresponding state space as a label transition system on the right side. So in general, partial reductions is the detection and pruning of redundant actions leavings. So let's look at how this works. So the transitions B and A are independent, and they are independent due to visually the characteristic diamond shape of the state space, where we can do A followed by B reaching the goal state, but we can also do B followed by A reaching the exact same state. So with partial reductions, we would choose to only explore one of these paths in the initial state, effectively pruning either this state or this state during the search of our goal state, in the search of our goal state. So that's partial reductions in the general case. So how does it work when we move it into the game theoretical setting? So now we have added an environment transition to our pitch net, which is transition C, and where B and A are now controller transitions. And the objective of this game now is not just are we able to reach the goal state. The objective is now also, does there exist a strategy that makes sure that we always reaches a goal state at some point in the case of reachability? And obviously the winning strategy for the controller here would be to always choose A in this state here, because then it will unhindered reach the goal state. But if it were to choose B, then the environment will get its transition C enabled and will then be able to fire that, moving into some state that is not the goal state. So the distinction between, so it's not enough that A and B are just independent. You need to consider whether or not one of them can potentially lead to states where the environment can do something that leads to unintended or unwanted behavior. So that's the game setting. What about the time setting? So in the time setting, we now enable delays in our model, where in the pitch net, it now becomes the timed arc pitch net, where the tokens are given an age, and where we have time-related formalisms, time-related constructions, such as invariants on places that restricts the age of tokens in places, guards that describes what ages of tokens that are accepted by those transitions, as well as states that can be urgent states, meaning that if they are enabled, then time is not allowed to elapse. And then we have, and that gives a certain delay actions in our state space, which is seen here from the state P2 leading to some state P2 plus 1. If you were to discretely age all the tokens in the pitch net by 1. So the unfortunate thing about the time setting is that due to the delay actions touching every single token in the pitch net, it means that every single action of the pitch net effectively becomes dependent upon each other due to time working as a global synchronizer, meaning that there are no such thing as redundant actions and leavings that we can exploit to using partial reductions. However, as we have shown in our work and what we have combined into the technique today, that we are showing today, is that in both settings you can actually do reductions, both in the game setting where you have to make sure you preserve the winning option between A and B, and also in a time setting where you can exploit something called urgency, where urgency in this case here are states where time is not allowed to elapse due to, for example, an urgent transitions being enabled, which is, for example, is the initial state here, or if there were to be a token in place P2 which had an age of 2, meaning that you cannot increase the age of that token anymore due to the invariant. All right, so next I will give some preliminaries for the paper. So the formalism that we consider is called time game label transition system, which consists of some states, some controllable actions, some environment actions, a transition relation that is labeled with either controllable actions, environment actions, or because it's also a timed formalism, some non-negative real. And then we also have some subset of states that we consider goal states. And here we see an example of such a transition system, exactly as the one we saw on the previous page. And we say that an action is enabled at a state if it is the label of an outgoing arc. All right. So next we have reductions. So a reduction is a function that that for a given state returns us a set of actions that we have to consider at a given state. And we call this the stop on set for that state. So as an example, for this example we see in the middle here, we have that the stop on set for the state S is the action C and D. And we can then make the reduced game relative to a reduction where we append the reduction to the transition relation where we remove all the actions that are not in the stop on set, like so. All right. Next, we have strategies, where in this paper we consider memoryless strategies, where such a strategy is given here by the function sigma, that given a state, either returns a tuple consisting of a controllable action as well as on some non-negative delay, or the strategy can also choose to return lambda, which in this case indicates that instead of executing a controllable action, it instead prefers to let time elapse without executing any of its actions. And lastly, we have that a run of a game is loosely defined as starting from a state is a sequence of states induced by an execution sequence of alternating delays and actions in that order. And then with that leads us now to the definitions of a winning reachability strategy, which is that some sigma is a winning reachability strategy for the controller if and only if for all maximal runs of runs a goal state is eventually reached. So what this means is that for all maximal runs is that this also includes all the possible strategies that the environment may make in order to prevent us from reaching the goal. So what this also means is for any possible strategy the environment may make to try to hinder us, we will still eventually reach a goal state. And similarly, we can define a safety strategy, which is that for all maximal runs, a goal state is never reached. Next, we will talk about the reachability conditions, which leads into one of the major results in the paper, which is the theorem you see on the slide here, which states that if some reduction satisfies this list of conditions, then for all states in the transition system, we have that there exists a winning reachability strategy for the controller in the original game G, if and only if there also exists a winning reachability strategy in the reduced game for the controller. And next, we will go over these conditions here. And on this slide here, we see the first condition, which is condition I, which states that if a state is a mixed state, then we have to include all enabled transitions, or all enabled actions rather, into the stop on set. So a mixed state is any state where there is an outgoing arc, both with our two outgoing arcs, one with a controllable action and one with an environment action. So as an example, this state is a mixed state. Next, we have the set condition, which is similar to the previous condition, which states that if a given state is a non-urgent state, then we include all enabled actions into the stop on set. And this obviously includes states such as P2, because as we said before, an urgent state is where time is not allowed to elapse. So a non-urgent state would be one where time is allowed to elapse. So that would be P2 due to the outgoing arc labeled with a delay action. Next, we have the commutativity condition W, which is a classical condition, which states that stop on actions commutes with all sequence of non-stop on actions. So as an example of that, in the initial state, if you were to include B as a stop on action, then it must be that for every sequence of non-stop on actions, we were able to commute. So for example, if we were to do A, B, then we should also be able to do B, A. So in this case, including B into the stop on set is sufficient to satisfy W. Next, we have the reach condition, which states that for every single state that is not a goal state, we must include some interesting set of actions given the goal state. We here call it for the interesting set of actions, but it also has other names in the literature, such as attractor sets. And as an example, again given the initial state, we have that either including A or B is sufficient to satisfy this condition. And the reason for this is that in order to reach a goal state, we have to execute either A or B to reach a goal state in any possible scenario. So therefore, either A or B are sufficient. This leads us to the time condition given here by the condition T, which states that only stubborn actions can enable delays. So this condition here is about the urgency of a state. So if you were to again take the initial state here, which is a urgent state, we must include all the actions that leads us to states where time can become enabled. That is, we must preserve the reachability of non-urgent states. So obviously in this model here, we have that P2 is at least in these states here, is the only non-urgent state. So therefore, in order to preserve the reachability of that, A must be included into the stop-on set, but B does not have to be included. Next, we have the two conditions called game one, as well as game two given here by the D1 and the D2 conditions. But in this case, I will only present one of these conditions because they are pretty much analogous to each other, because one pertains to the controller, while the other one is about the environment. So here we consider the controller for G1. So this condition states that for each reachable mixed or environment state, a run to that state is preserved. So what this means is that if you are in a state like P1 and P2, which is a controller state, due to all outgoing actions or outgoing labels on transitions being controllable actions, then this is a controller state, and we must be able to preserve paths to states where the some environment action becomes enabled. So obviously B here must be included, because this is the one that leads us to this state here where C becomes enabled, but there's no such thing for A, so therefore for this condition B is sufficient. The S condition, or rather also the safe condition, states that stop-on actions may never eventually lead to mixed or environment states. So what this means is that we want to take care of including all the actions that are safe. And safeness here means that actions that, if they were to be fired, would never lead to a state where some environment action becomes enabled. So obviously from the initial state, we have that the A action is safe because it will never reach a state where environment action becomes enabled. But on the contrary, B is not a safe action, because it leads obviously to this state here where the environment action C becomes enabled. And realistically, this means that if B is in the stop-on set, then we, for safety, will have to include every other enabled control action in order to ensure that if there is a winning choice, we preserve it. Next, we have a bit of a different condition, which is here called the V condition, also called the visibility condition, which states that environment actions may never eventually lead to a goal state. And to give a bit more explanation to this, I have here included a little different example, where we see a state space only consisting of environment actions. So in this particular case here, we see that the previous conditions are presented, such as the R condition, will in this state here preserve a path to goal states. So it would have to include A into the stop-on set in order to reach this goal state here. But if you look at this from a game theoretical point of view, we have that the environment does indeed have a strategy that avoids reaching a goal state by choosing B here as its option for its strategy. But if we were to just apply the other conditions blindly, such as the R condition, we would end up pruning this path here and thereby turning a game that is not winnable for the controller into a reduced game that is winnable. And therefore, our methodology will not be correct. So therefore, we need to include this V condition, which means that in a case like this, where the environment can on its own reach a goal state, we must basically include all actions or somehow include the B action in order to ensure that we preserve the validity. And last, we have the D condition, which is also one of the more classical conditions within stop on sets, which is used for preserving deadlocks. And this condition loosely states that if the environment has at least one enabled key action, then that action cannot become disabled by non-stop on actions. And here it is specifically environment actions and not controller actions we are dealing with. And we have that this condition, in particular with the W condition, is sufficient to preserve deadlocks in the environment part of the state space. But also, this condition here is also sufficient together with W for preserving all cycles of environment actions. And this kind of deals with two of the scenarios where the environment may have a winning strategy. In the first case, where it's possible to reach a deadlock that is not a goal state, and in the second case, being able to reach a cycle where the environment can keep repeating some cycle of its actions. And so far, we have only really talked about the reachability conditions. So here at the end here, let's also talk a bit about safety games, or the safety conditions rather. And in fact, the only thing we need to change is that we need to change the conditions V and D that previously only pertained to the environment. Well, we now have to replace these with the V prime and D prime conditions, where the only difference is that we replace all instances of the environment with the controller. So instead of considering the environment actions, in these two updated conditions, we are now only considering the controller actions. And this leads us into another theorem, which by replacing the V and D conditions by these updated conditions, we now have that there is some winning safety strategy in the original game, if and only if there is some winning safety strategy also in the reduced game. All right, let's talk about the instantiation of this framework and these conditions to time dark patronet games, where on this slide I will give some examples of how we over approximate these conditions in this setting. So first off, let's talk about interesting transitions pertaining to the R condition. So let's say for this patronet we have on the slide here that our goal states are the states where the place P1 has exactly zero tokens. In that case, for this particular marking, we have that the interesting transitions are those that decrease the number of tokens that are in P1. And this corresponds exactly to the transition A, but not transition B. And in fact, the set consisting of just A is a sufficient interesting set for this goal objective and is sufficient for satisfying the R condition. Next, let's talk about safe transitions, where in this case we have this lemma that roughly states that if a transition does not consume or produce tokens that may enable an environment transition, then that transition T is definitely safe in any marking. So example of that is B, for example, is definitely not safe since it produces tokens at the place P3, which may enable this transition C. However, on the other hand, we have that the A transition is definitely safe because it doesn't put any tokens into P3. Next, we are moving into the implementation and experiments part of this presentation, where on this slide here we see a screenshot from the verification tool suite called Tapal, which is a model checking tool for time dark patronets. And within this tool, we have implemented the framework that I have been talking about so far. But also more specifically, what is implemented in here is the instantiation of this framework to time dark patronet games. And within this model checking tool, we have a number of models from which we base our experimental evaluation. So these four models we have, these five models we have, is called fire alarm, blood transfusion, Lymphure, Lyngby Small, and COVID spreading, all of which are scaled by some element within these models. So the fire alarm is scaled by the number of wireless sensors which report to a central unit. Blood transfusion is scaled by the number of units or number of patients receiving transfusions. And Lymphure, which models the Lymphure bridge in Aalborg, is scaled by the number of both lanes that are available on the bridge, the number of cars that has to pass the bridge, as well as the time frame available for all of the cars to cross the bridge. Lyngby Small is a model of the Lyngby train station, also in Denmark, which is scaled by the number of trains entering the station. And lastly, we have the COVID spreading model, which is a model that simulates people moving through a tight corridor, and it's scaled by the number of people that has to safely pass through this corridor while maintaining social distance. On this slide here, we see some of the experimental results of our paper listed in this table. So to give some explanation to how this table is set up, we see in the leftmost column we have the model column, where we have the names of the models as well as a number indicating their scaling. In the next column we have the times column, which is in seconds, and in this column we have another two subcolumns, where one is called normal and the other one is called poor, and they're respectively normal, where it is the time it spends for Tapal to solve the model without partial reductions, while the poor column is the time it takes for Tapal to solve the model with partial reductions. And similarly, we have the markings column, which is in thousands. We have a normal and poor subcolumn, and in the last column we have the reduction column, one for the time and one for the markings, which gives us the number of times more time or number of times more markings that has to be searched in order to finish verifying the model, which can both be a positive number indicating a reduction, but it can also be a negative number indicating that applying a partial reduction has actually made it harder to solve these models. So to look at some of these models here, we see that in particular the fire alarm model, it scales as it scales up to a higher instance, the effectiveness of partial reduction becomes more and more apparent, to the point where once you have 100 fire alarms active, it is not possible for Tapal to solve this model without partial reductions, and it times out in this case here. In the other two cases, we have the blood transfusion. We have that the reduction is a bit more moderate, but it's still positive towards the partial auto reduction side. And then in contrast to that, we have the Lyngby Small model, where it starts out having a very good or effective reduction, but then as the model becomes larger, the effectiveness of partial reductions becomes minimized, and eventually it becomes detrimental, to the point where we spend more than three times as much time to solve the model. As for the remaining two models we have on this slide here, the remaining data seen in this table here. So as for the Lymphure model, we see that as the Lymphure model scales to larger instances, we see that the reduction both in the time spent verifying the model as well as the markings searched, we see that the reduction becomes steadily better and better as it scales up to a larger instance, which is for partial reductions in general the best case scenario. For the COVID model, unfortunately, we see that while there is some reduction, like a 10 to 20% reduction, which is not really that noticeable on the small models, where the time is less, is only in a few seconds to solve it, we see that even as it scales up to one of the larger models, that the reduction is not really that impactful, unfortunately. So to tie it all up, I will now provide a conclusion to this presentation. So first and foremost, the main thing we did during this paper, or in this paper, is that we combined our previous work on partial reductions for respectively time systems and readability games into a unified framework for timed games and timed readability games. And we showed that while the previous work only focused on readability games, we showed in this work that with only a few tweaks to the existing conditions, that we can also preserve winning safety strategies in addition to readability. This framework was then instantiated to a more concrete formalism, in this case of timed arc passionate games, and implemented into the TAPAL verification tool field, on which we provided a number of models and did an experimental evaluation. And in this experimental evaluation, we saw that on a lot of the models that we had a very good, in some cases, exponential time and space reduction. And in some other cases, it wasn't as effective. As for the future work in relation to specifically this paper, I think the main thing to focus on would be relaxing some of the more prohibitive conditions of the framework, in the particular the I and the Z conditions, and also looking for more places in which you can make optimizations. Thank you for your time.
So thanks a lot, Frederick. So the talk was quite clear, thanks a lot. I see there are any questions, not yet. So I'll start maybe with questions on your experimental evaluation that you described extensively. So first question is about the case where the partial auto-reduction is actually not beneficial. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned in the paper that it's related to a change in the search order in the tool. So maybe you can say something about that.
Yeah. So when no reduction is applied, then you're searching through the entire state space. So there's, of course, more ways in which you can reach a point where you reach a goal state or reach a point where you have synthesized a full strategy. So then after applying reduction, the search order may change due to that. So depending on if you have a positive or negative result to your query, then also like in the general case of reachability, but also strategy synthesis, you may end up spending more time due to some options being removed. Even though they're redundant, they may still, due to like certain like implementation specific, not exactly randomness, but some of it can turn can make it worse in that way.
Okay, thank you. Then my second question is actually kind of related. It's a really naive question. So when you are doing something like this partial order prediction, we see that in some cases it's beneficial, in some cases it's not. So do you have any idea a priori, when you've got some application, if, okay, this is an application, this is a model where this partial order reduction, I should use it or I should not. And yeah. I guess that there are some naive models in which it's obvious that you should do it, but mm-hmm. in a real case, can you say something or do you just have to try?
In general, a lot of these conditions are very cheap to calculate. So I think for most models, it doesn't hurt to try it. Even if it gives results or it doesn't. In terms of if you look at a model specifically for games in particular, I talked about this non-mixed versus mixed states and these things during the presentation, which is whether or not a non-mixed state is a state where only the controller can do something or only the environment can do something. So something that was in a previous paper we did was that if you know your model is entirely non-mixed, as in that it is strictly divided into whenever the controller and environment can do something, then a lot of these conditions can either be removed or they can be relaxed. So in those cases, you may think that, okay, here we can do it. For time, if you know there's no urgency in your system, then it's very hard to do partial reductions, because we exploit this urgency concept, which basically says, while time is basically eliminated, we can apply classical conditions with no restriction. And the in the case where time is enabled, that is a well, let's say it's a very hard unsolved question if you can even do anything in those cases.
Okay, thank you. So I'm seeing no other question. I guess we can close the session here. Thanks again for your talk and the nice answers.
Thank you.
Thank you to everyone that was here for the session. So have a good afternoon. So we'll be back after the break at, I think it's 3:45. Let me check. Yeah. See you. Thanks again to everyone.